This video is a short aside that also explains the cover of your textbook. So here's a sample CPU architecture with the caches. So for each core, we have the registers. We also have an L1 data cache as well as an L1 instruction cache. And then we have an L2 unified cache per core that stores both data and instructions. And then there's an L3 unified cache that is shared by all the cores, but is still on the CPU. And then finally, there's main memory, which is not on the CPU and connected via a bus. So here's a question to think about. So as the working set size of a loop decreases, so this is all of the data that is accessed by a loop. So as that decreases, what generally happens to the read throughput? So think about that for a second and pause the video and see if you can identify which of these is correct. Okay, so as the working set size decreases, this means that it's going to fit into higher and higher levels of the memory hierarchy, which means that the read throughput is going to increase because the higher levels of the hierarchy are faster. And so if you did a series of experiments, you might get a graph that looks like this. So as you decrease the working set size, so moving from 128 megabytes all the way down to 16 kilobytes, you'll see that the read throughput is gradually increasing. And you see some of these, kind of jumps, and those jumps correspond to the working set size fitting into higher and higher levels of the memory hierarchy. So here we have to store it in main memory. Here we can store all of it inside of L3. Here we can store it all in L2. And here we can store it all in L1. Okay, so we could also think about what happens to the read throughput as the stride of a loop increases. So as we are skipping through data in larger and larger intervals, what's generally going to happen to the read throughput? So again, you should pause the video and think about this for a bit. So as we are skipping more and more things, we are basically depriving ourselves of the benefit of having the caching system, which brings in things that are close to each other. And so as the stride of the loop increases, the read throughput is going to go down because we're not taking as much advantage of our caches. And so we'll end up with a graph that looks like this. So as the stride increases, we're going to see this gradual decrease in the read throughput until eventually it kind of levels off down here, where we're essentially doing only one access per cache line, and we're basically not taking advantage of our cache at all. Okay, so what this all leads to is we have this set of experiments with working set size. So in this previous one, we have working set size versus throughput, and then we have another set of experiments, which is stride versus throughput. And so the authors of our textbook observed that you can put these sets of experiments together into a three-dimensional graph, and you end up with a picture that looks like this. So here you have the stride on this axis, and you have the working set size on this axis, and then the data points that are graphed in the third dimension are the read throughput. And so, you know, on the working set size, you can see these bumps, these ridges, and as the textbook authors point out, these are sort of ridges of temporal locality, things that are accessed together. If you can fit them into higher levels of cache, you see these spikes in performance when something can fit into a higher level of the hierarchy. And then you have these slopes of spatial locality, where if you're not taking advantage of accessing things that are close together, you're eventually going to, your read throughput is going to go down. And so you're left with this very nice little diagram that characterizes a particular CPU and memory architecture. So the textbook did this for a Core i7 Haswell, but they also provided the code that you need in order to generate this for your own machine. And so I've run this on Stu various times over the years, and this is what the mountain looks like for Stu in 2017. And you can see the same basic layout here, where we have these ridges and then we have these slopes. One interesting thing is what happened between 2017 and 2018. So when I ran this in 2017, the graph looked like this, and these are the stats for that year. The next year, the graph actually looked a little bit different, and so I went investigating to find out why this was. and found that the machine had been upgraded between those 2 years. And so the CPU was upgraded, but also the L3 cache size was increased. So if you look at the L3 cache size from 2017, it is roughly 16 megabytes. And then it got doubled to, I guess, roughly, you know, 32 megabytes in 2018. And you can see this in the graph because that range for L3, that sort of the ridge there in the orange section, that got bigger and started to take over more of the range from main memory. Because, you know, once you increase the size, then you'll have larger working set sizes that can fit inside of it, and you're going to get better performance. So hopefully this not only explains that picture that's been on the front of your textbook all semester, but it also kind of gives you an appreciation for how these things make a difference in the real world.